Wow! That couple is getting married. And they have invited you to their wedding. What are you gonna do? Do you know anything about Western weddings? Well, in this lesson, I'm going to teach you everything you need to know about Western weddings. Okay, hey, if you like getting tips like this, I would be so happy if you subscribe to my channel right down there. Okay, so the first thing that is going to happen is you are going to get a wedding invitation. A wedding invitation. It's going to be very fancy, like this. It's going to be a nice card, probably homemade. A lot of couples make their own wedding invitations. They're very fancy. Inside the invitation, there is going to be some information, okay? Who's getting married, which day the wedding is, what time. Okay, so you should keep your wedding invitation. Now, one of the differences between Western weddings and weddings in countries like India is that Western weddings are only one day. That's a huge difference. That's probably the biggest difference. Okay, actually, it's not even a day. It's like half a day. It's only a few hours, the whole thing. Now, a wedding is made up of two parts, okay? The ceremony and the reception. The ceremony is the part that usually happens in a church, right? It's the official part where they actually get married. It usually takes place in a church, but it could also happen somewhere outside, like on a beach, or in the mountains somewhere, okay? Then, after the ceremony is the reception. The reception, that's basically like the party after the wedding, okay? That's where everyone eats food and eats cake and they might dance, drink wine, that kind of stuff, okay? That happens at the reception. Now, you might be invited to the ceremony and the reception, or you might just be invited to the ceremony. Everyone does it a little bit different, okay? Like, sometimes people invite lots of people to the ceremony, but then they only invite their close friends and family to the reception, because the reception can be quite expensive, right? To pay for food for like a few hundred people, that can be thousands and thousands of dollars. So if the couple is very poor, you know, they might only invite their close friends and family to the reception. So if that's the case, then after the ceremony, you just leave and you go home. It's done. But if you are invited to the reception, then you need to go to that as well. That's the fun part. Actually, the ceremony is usually pretty boring. Okay, so when you go to the ceremony, okay, one thing you need to know is you should arrive early, okay? Early. Now, I know weddings in India and those countries, a lot of times people arrive late, okay? But here, the timing is actually really important. You should arrive 30 minutes early. So if it says in your invitation that the wedding is at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, you should arrive at 2:30, okay? So what's going to happen when you walk through the doors? Do you know what to do? Well, the first thing you're going to see is you're going to see someone sitting at a table with a guest book. A guest book, okay? So it's our custom here in Canada, the US, okay, that all the guests sign the guest book. You don't have to write anything fancy, just read what other people have written. You could just say, wishing you all the best, or congratulations, and then your name, John or Mary, okay? And then you could ask her, you could say, is there a gift table? Because you probably brought a gift for the couple, right? So there's going to be somewhere in the church where there is a table with the gifts on it. Okay, so then you go there and you put your gift there. Then the usher, one of the ushers, will escort you to your seat. He will show you where you should sit, okay? These people are called the ushers, okay? So then you just, after the usher has shown you where you should sit, just sit there and wait. Then you're going to hear some music. That means the ceremony is starting. Then you're going to see the groom. The person who's getting married, the man, is called the groom, walk out to the front of the church with his groomsmen. His groomsmen, okay? These are his best friends. Usually a groom picks his best friends or maybe his brother or something like that to be his groomsmen. Now, the main groomsman, the person standing closest to the groom, is called the best man, the best man. Okay, he's not the best man at the wedding. The groom is the best man at the wedding, but he is the second best. I don't know why it's called the best man, because actually the groom is the best man. Okay, then the ushers will bring the bridesmaids down the aisle. Okay, the bridesmaids are the bride's friends, just like the groomsmen and the bridesmaids. Okay, so this is what the front of the church will look like. Okay, the bridesmaids will be brought in one by one down the aisle until they're all there. Usually, there are the same number of groomsmen as bridesmaids. So if there are three groomsmen, there will be three bridesmaids. Okay, and the main bridesmaid is called the maid of honor. The maid of honor, just like the best man. Okay, so the people here are called the wedding party. The wedding party, except we're missing the bride, right? The bride is also in the wedding party. Now, party can have two meanings, right? A party can mean like a birthday party where everyone gets together, but the word party can also mean group. Okay, so this is a group, the wedding group. You, as a guest, are not in the wedding party. You're just sitting there watching. These people are actually participating in the wedding, so they are called the wedding party. Okay, so then you're going to hear some different music. The bride is going to walk in, and the father is going to be escorting her down the aisle. Okay, so then the front of the church is going to look like this. The bridesmaids over there, the groomsmen over here, the bride, the groom, and the person who is marrying them. It might be a priest, a pastor, or a justice of the peace. Okay, if it's a Catholic wedding, it will probably be a priest. If it's a Protestant wedding, it will be a pastor. And if it's a non-religious wedding, then it might be a justice of the peace. Okay, that's just the legal representative from the government who has the power to marry. Here in Canada, I don't know, is it the same in your country? Do you need someone officially to sign the documents or something like that? Okay, anyway, here in Canada, you do need someone like this. Okay, so probably the priest or the pastor will give a short sermon, just a talk on love and marriage. Okay, then the couple will say their vows. I, John, take you, Mary, to be my lawfully wedded wife, to have and to hold for this day forth, whatever. If you want to look up wedding vows, just Google wedding vows. Couples choose their own vows. There are lots of different kinds of wedding vows, so you can just Google it if you want to see some examples. Okay, then they will exchange rings. Okay, they'll put rings on each other's fingers, and then they will sign the wedding document. Okay, they'll go over to the side of the stage and they'll sign the document, and then the pastor will probably say, I pronounce you man and wife, you may now kiss the bride. They'll kiss, and then they will walk out of the church, and there'll be happy music, everyone will be clapping and cheering, and it will be a very happy occasion. Okay, then that's pretty much it. That's the end of the ceremony. Okay, so that actually goes by really quickly. This whole ceremony can be finished in 30 minutes or 45 minutes. Did you know that? A Western wedding, the weddings that I've been to have been very short, like maybe an hour at the most, but usually more like 30 minutes. Okay, then that's it. Then it's done. Then the couple goes off to take wedding pictures. The whole wedding party goes to take somewhere to take wedding pictures for several hours. Okay, it takes several hours. And then after the pictures are finished, that is when the reception starts. Okay, so when you go to the reception, you're going to see a big table at the front of the reception. That is called the head table. Now, you might be wondering, what do you do between the ceremony and the reception? If there are a few hours, there might be 2 or 3 hours in between there. Well, you can do whatever you want. If you're close to your house, you can go back to your house. You could just stay somewhere. I don't know. Very often the reception is at the same place as the church. It's a lot of times it happens in the church basement, the bottom floor of the church. But sometimes it happens at like a community center or some special hall or something like that. So you might have to drive from the church to the place where the reception is happening. I don't know. So anyway, you can do whatever you want in that time gap. Okay, but this is what you'll see. The front of the reception room, the area, is going to be the head table with the wedding party. Okay, now what's going to happen in the reception is everyone's going to eat and drink, but there will also be like a program. Okay, some people will give toasts. That's a main part of the reception program. A toast is a short speech where you say something and then you raise your glass, your glass of wine or juice or whatever, and you make a toast. You say, please raise your glasses with me in a toast to the groom. Okay, so first, this guy, maybe the best man, will give a toast to the groom. Okay, so he's going to go to the area where there's the mic, and he might say, I've known John for 15 years. He's a great guy, but I want to tell you some funny stories about him. Okay, and he might tell some stories for 5 or 10 minutes, and then he's going to raise his glass and make a toast to the groom. Then maybe the maid of honor will go and give a toast to the bride. You know, maybe their parents will go and say something, or maybe some other people will say something. And then they might have an open mic time. Open mic, that means anybody can go to the microphone and say some nice things about the couple. Okay, very often weddings have open mic times. Okay. Then after the reception, the couple is just going to leave on their honeymoon. That's it. So when they leave, everything is finished. That's the end of the party. You know, very often, the couple won't tell people where they're going on the honeymoon. It might be a surprise. Okay, so everyone is asking, where are you guys going on your honeymoon? Very often that's the case, but sometimes it's not. Or sometimes the bride doesn't know where they're going either. He has booked the honeymoon. Like, for example, when my brother got married, he booked a honeymoon, but he didn't tell his wife. It was a surprise. Okay, so that happens sometimes. So they go on their honeymoon for 1 or 2 weeks, and then they have a nice time on their honeymoon, maybe to Mexico, Cuba, Europe, who knows, anywhere. Okay, Hawaii. Hawaii is a popular spot for honeymoons as well. Okay, but that's basically how a wedding goes in our culture. Now, you might be wondering what you should give them as a gift. Well, I made a separate video on how to give gifts, birthday gifts, wedding gifts, Mother's Day gifts. Okay, I'll post that video right over here, right up here at the end of this lesson. Okay, but let's do some homework. I want to know, how are weddings different in your culture? I'm sure weddings are pretty different in your culture compared to Western culture. But anyway, let me know your answer down there in the comments, and I'll see you over in the next episode of Mad English TV. Take care.